Good morning and welcome to our service of Holy Communion for Easter Sunday. As we process to the altar, I will raise the candle and say the light of Christ. Will you please respond, Alleluia, Christ is risen. The light of Christ, Alleluia, Christ is risen. The light of Christ.
Hallelujah. Christ is risen.
The light of Christ. The light of Christ.
Hallelujah. Christ is risen.
Hallelujah. Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Alleluia. We start our service this morning by singing together hymn number 348, Jesus Christ is risen today. Be seated. So we turn to our order of service. Can you all hear me all right? Can you turn me up a little? Thank you. That better? Brilliant. So on your order of service, which you should all have a copy of, And we turn to the prayer of preparation. And we say together, Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. Christ, our Passover lamb, has been sacrificed for us. Let us therefore rejoice by putting away all malice and evil and confessing our sins with a sincere and true heart. Most merciful God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, we confess that we have sinned in thought, word, and deed. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbours as ourselves. In your mercy, forgive what we have been. Help us to amend what we are and direct what we shall be, that we may do justly, love mercy, and walk humbly with you, our God. Amen. May the God of love and power forgive you and free you from your sins, heal and strengthen you by his Spirit, and raise you to new life in Christ. Amen. Would you please stand?
Glory to God, glory to God.
Please be seated. And we pray the collect for Easter Sunday. Lord of all life and power, who through the mighty resurrection of your Son overcame the old order of sin and death to make all things new in him, grant that we, being dead to sin and alive to you in Jesus Christ, may reign with him in glory, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be praise and honour, glory and might, now and in all eternity. Amen. Now invite Newman to come and give us a word from God.
The first reading is from Isaiah chapter 25. On this mountain, the Lord of hosts will make for all peoples a feast of rich food, a feast of well-matured wines, of rich food filled with marrow, of well-matured wines strained clear. And he will destroy on this mountain the shroud that is cast over all peoples, the sheet that is spread over all nations. He will swallow up death forever. Then the Lord God will wipe away the tears from all faces, and the disgrace of his people he will take away from all the earth, for the Lord has spoken. It will be said on that day, "Lo, this is our God. We have waited for him so that he might save us. This is the Lord for whom we have waited. Let us be glad and rejoice in his salvation." The second reading is from Corinthians chapter 15. Now I should remind you, brothers and sisters, of the good news that I proclaimed to you, which you in turn received, in which also you stand, through which also you are being saved. If you hold firmly to the message that I proclaimed to you, unless you have come to believe in vain. For I handed on to you as of first importance what I in turn had received, that Christ died for our sins in accordance with the Scriptures, and that he was buried, and that he was raised on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures, and that he appeared to Cephas, then to the 12. Then he appeared to more than 500 brothers and sisters at one time, most of whom are still alive, though some have died. Then he appeared to James, then to all the apostles. Last of all, as to someone untimely born, he appeared also to me. For I am the least of the apostles, unfit to be called an apostle, because I persecuted the church of God. But by the grace of God, I am what I am, and his grace towards me has not been in vain. On the contrary, I worked harder than any of them, though it was not I, but the grace of God that is with me. Whether then it was I or they, so we proclaim, and so you have come to believe. This is the word of the Lord.
Our next hymn is number 195 from Heaven You Came, Helpless Babe, better known as The Servant King.
To be served and to serve. Alleluia, alleluia. I am the first and the last, says the Lord, the living one. I was dead, and behold, I am alive forevermore. Alleluia. Hear the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to St. Mark. When the Sabbath was over, Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of James, and Salome brought spices so that they might go and anoint him. And very early, on the first day of the week, when the sun had risen, they went to the tomb. They'd been saying to one another, "Who will roll away the stone for us from the entrance to the tomb?" When they looked up, they saw that the stone, which was very large, had already been rolled back. As they entered the tomb, they saw a young man, dressed in a white robe, sitting on the right side, and they were alarmed. But he said to them, "Do not be alarmed. You are looking for Jesus of Nazareth, who was crucified. He has been raised. He is not here. Look, there is the place where they laid him. But go, tell his disciples and Peter that he is going ahead of you to Galilee. And there you will see him, just as he told you." So they went out and fled from the tomb, for terror and amazement had seized them. And they said nothing to anyone, for they were afraid. This is the gospel of the Lord. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Do not be alarmed. You are looking for Jesus of Nazareth, who was crucified. He has been raised. He is not here. Well, what are we to make of St. Mark's account of the first Easter day? It ends with a group of frightened women fleeing from the empty tomb. And they say nothing to anyone because they are afraid. It ends very suddenly. There is no appearance of the risen Christ. For the verses that follow in chapter 16 of Mark's Gospel were probably added afterwards. They're not by the original author. So even the earliest Christians thought that this ending, this sudden ending, was stark. So that those who worked on copying early editions of Mark's Gospel saw fit to add a more elaborate ending, complete with resurrection appearances and even a hint of the ascension. Yet, if we think about it, the very suddenness serves to bring out the feeling of shock and fear that there must have been among those women on that first Easter morning. They'd gone to the tomb. They'd gone there to embalm the body of Jesus with spices. Then on the way, they remember that the tomb has been sealed with a large stone. They're wondering who's going to move it for them. And then they reach the tomb and see the stone has been moved. And inside the tomb, they encounter a young man dressed in a white robe. Now, whether or not he's an angel, I suppose we can think about. But this messenger tells them not to be alarmed. Jesus, whom they seek, is not there. He is risen. He is going before them to Galilee, and there they will see him. And then those women flee in terror. And they flee because it appears that what Jesus said would happen has happened. It is the third day, and he is risen. Also, it would seem from the account that they do not tell the disciples or Peter. So they are understandably afraid. So afraid, in fact. They're afraid of the authorities who had put Jesus to death, who are not going to be very pleased to hear that he's alive after all. They're going to be afraid of the disciples, especially the 11, that they might not believe them. Because we have to remember that at that time and in that society, the uncorroborated evidence of a woman was not usually accepted in a court of law. And they were afraid that people might think they were mad. After all, what other reason could there be for them to say that a man who'd been publicly executed was still alive? But as well as being afraid, they're amazed. And it's the fact of their amazement that produces their fear. They do not seem at this point anyway to have the faith to believe that Jesus is risen. A faith, if we think about it, that would cast out their fear. And we must remember that it did take the friends and followers of Jesus a little time to take on board what has happened. As well as the empty tomb, there were to be the appearances of the risen Christ. So the women were amazed. The women were afraid. And this is the effect the resurrection might have upon us too. We can be amazed. Is it real? Did it happen? Is it true? These are questions that we as Christians will have been asked, and indeed may have asked ourselves. We have the witness of the Gospels to the resurrection. We have the faith and teaching of the church down 2,000 years, starting with the apostles and especially St. Paul. We may be afraid, but St. Mark's account of that first Easter day is a challenge to us. Do not be afraid. Do not be amazed. Believe Christ is risen. Do not be afraid. Have faith. And so, like those women, like those disciples, we must overcome our amazement and our fear, and like them, come to know the presence of the risen Christ with us, accepting that gift of faith and knowledge of the risen Lord, that faith and knowledge that casts out fear. And knowing the risen Christ, those earliest Christians were prepared to bear witness to him. They were prepared to take up their cross and follow him. And we too must be prepared to bear witness to the risen Christ, despite the world around us that remains amazed and fearful. The world around us that sometimes seems that it would rather that Jesus had not risen, that he'd remained dead in his tomb, because people sometimes find the influence of his life and teaching very inconvenient. And the working of the Holy Spirit in the world is just something they can't cope with. It's especially important for us to bear witness to our risen Lord, to those around us, those who we may know, who are quite prepared to accept that Jesus was a good man, Jesus was a great moral teacher, who may even, in some sense, see themselves as being Christians because they follow Christ's ethical teaching, but who regard the talk of Jesus as the Son of God and his resurrection as just nice Sunday school stories for children, because they have not recognized the presence of the risen Christ and allowed him into their lives. And We must also bear witness to those who regard our faith as at best something rather quaint, and at worst perhaps a sign of madness, or those who see being a Christian and being involved with the church as just another sort of leisure activity that people indulge in. What it's always important to remember is that we are the Easter people, and we must bring true Easter joy to those around us. Now, there's another reason why on that first Easter day those women were frightened. And it's something that we may also find rather unsettling. They were afraid because they had witnessed the result of God's direct intervention in the world. Now, like us, the women did not actually witness the resurrection. As far as we know, no human being did. Because the resurrection is not the same as some historical events, like, for example, the Battle of Hastings. But it's real, it happened, and it's true. But it's something that takes place, in a way, outside of time and space. It happens in eternity. We might say that for a moment, time and eternity collided, and that what the women saw and what we see and bear witness to, as the church has for 2,000 years, are the results of it. And as we gather at the Lord's table shortly, in a sense, for a moment, time and eternity will collide again as we are caught up in a foretaste in the heavenly banquet at one with the angels and archangels and all the company of heaven. Now, of course, it can be frightening to encounter the risen Lord. In the book of Revelation, St. John writes of his encounter with the risen Lord, the living one. This is in the first chapter, and it's actually the traditional New Testament reading for morning prayer on Easter Sunday. Now, St. John, there he is. He's afraid. He collapsed. He's overcome by terror, but then he's reassured. Fear not, I am the first and the last and the living one. I died, and behold, I am alive forevermore. As I say, our encounter with the risen Christ might be frightening because of that realization that Christ is risen and is among us, and because of the power of the Holy Spirit, because of what we are called to do. And as Jesus, in his risen body, appeared to the disciples in the upper room, he appeared to them on the road to Emmaus, he appeared to them by the Sea of Galilee, so he comes to us, and we must recognize his presence and respond to that promise of new life that it brings. The risen Lord is here. His Spirit is with us. And shortly we affirm our belief and trust in him. We gather at the Lord's table to proclaim God's mighty works in Christ, recognizing his presence with us as we receive him in the bread and wine of the Holy Communion. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. And that's what we celebrate on this Easter day, indeed on every Sunday as the day of the resurrection, that we are the body of Christ, and our risen and glorified Saviour says to us, do not be afraid, for I have redeemed you. I have called you by your name, and you are mine.
Thanks, Reverend David. If you're able, would you please stand as we say the words of the Creed to affirm that faith that David just spoke of. We believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in the Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate from the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and was made man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Would you please be seated as we come to our time of prayer, which will be led by Reverend Diana.
Lord, our God, we give you thanks and praise for on that first Easter day you raised your Son, Jesus Christ, triumphant over death, sin, and evil. In his death, you have destroyed death, and in his rising to life, you have opened to us the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. With the whole church throughout the world and in heaven, we rejoice in the joy of our risen Lord and for his appearance to his beloved disciples. May we who know the good news go and tell others that he is risen with the same enthusiasm and joy as Mary after the encounter with her risen Lord at the empty tomb. Risen Lord, hear our prayer. We pray for the world which Christ died to redeem. Lord, guide with your wisdom all who have authority over nations or local communities. Whatever problems they must face and overcome, and in all their decisions and negotiations, may they work for justice and peace. We ask you to transform with your peace and hope the lives of those caught up in terrorism and war in Ukraine, the Holy Land, and the many other areas of the world where there is civil conflict, violence, and oppression. And we ask you to strengthen all who work to bring peace to troubled peoples and communities. Risen Lord, hear our prayer. Risen Lord Jesus, we praise you for the love that surrounds us each day through our families, friends, and the fellowship of the church. Yet we pray for the needy in society, the homeless, the anxious and lonely, the poor, the outcast, the vulnerable, and those who do not know you. Make us aware of them and eager to help. May we live each day in the light of Easter, with its joy bubbling up in our hearts and its message always on our lips, that those around us may be drawn into your wonderful love. Risen Lord, hear our prayer. Risen Lord Jesus, we offer our prayers for those who are sick in hospital, hospice, or in care, and for those who are ill at home. We ask your healing touch upon all who are suffering in body, mind, or spirit. Relieve them of all that troubles them and give them your comfort and peace through the love and care of those who tend to them. In a moment of quiet, we light a candle of peace and bring before you those known to us and all who are named on our regular prayer diary. Father, we bring to you a young lady, Karen, in intensive care here on the Isle of Wight. Risen Lord, hear our prayer. Risen Lord Jesus, we rejoice with your disciples and all the saints in your victory over death. We remember with love our dear ones departed, giving thanks for the love we shared and the happy memories to cherish. We pray too for those who mourn the loss of the recently departed, Harry Flux, Patricia Forward, Patrick Methold, Pam Bedlow, Pamela Merton, and from our church family, Michael Hall and Joan Hall. And we light a candle of hope and pray that they may rejoice with us this Easter day with the fullness of your light and peace in life eternal. Risen Lord, hear our prayer. We thank you, Father, for the gift of Easter, reminding us of your boundless love and grace. In the name of our risen Lord Jesus Christ. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen. Would you please stand, if you're able, for the peace? The risen Christ came and stood among his disciples and said, "Peace be with you." Then they were glad when they saw the Lord. Alleluia. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you. Alleluia.
Let us offer one another a sign of peace.
Our next hymn is number 362, Jesus Stand Amongst Us.
Thank you.
My apologies. Can you hear me now? No, what have I done with my glasses? Start again. The Lord is here. His Spirit is with us. Lift up your hearts. We lift them to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give thanks and praise. It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, always and everywhere to give you praise, Almighty and Eternal Father, to celebrate with joyful hearts the memory of your wonderful works. For the mystery of your passion, Jesus Christ, your risen Son, has conquered the powers of death and hell and restored in man and woman the image of your glory. He has placed them once more in paradise and opened to them the gate of the eternal. And so in the joy of this Passover, earth and heaven resound with gladness, with angels and archangels and the powers of all creation sing forever the hymn of your glory.
Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest.
Lord, you are holy indeed, the source of all holiness. Grant that by the power of your Holy Spirit and according to your holy will, these gifts of bread and wine may be to us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, who in the same night that he was betrayed, he took bread and gave you thanks. He broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup and gave you thanks. He gave it to them, saying, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me." Great is the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. And so, Father, calling to mind his death on the cross, his perfect sacrifice made once for the sins of the whole world, rejoicing in his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension, and looking for his coming in glory, we celebrate this memorial of our redemption as we offer you this, our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. We bring before you this bread and this cup, and we thank you for counting us worthy to stand in your presence and serve you. Send your Holy Spirit upon your people, and gather into one in your kingdom all who share this one bread and one cup through Jesus Christ our Lord. By whom and with whom and in whom, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honour and glory be yours, Almighty Father, for ever and ever.
Amen.
Please be seated. So let us pray with confidence as our Saviour has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ. Though we are many, we are one body, because we all share in one bread. Alleluia, Christ our Passover is sacrificed for us. Therefore, let us keep the feast. Alleluia. Everybody is most welcome to come forward for communion, but if you would prefer to receive a blessing, just please just indicate that to me. Let us pray. God of life, who for our redemption gave your only begotten Son to the death of the cross, and by his glorious resurrection have delivered us from the power of our enemy, grant us so to die daily to sin, that we may evermore live with him in the joy of his risen life. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And we say together, Almighty God, we thank you for feeding us with the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him we offer you our souls and bodies to be a living sacrifice. Send us out in the power of your Spirit to live and work to your praise and glory. Amen. This is a Church of England church, and where would we be without notices? Wendy? Oh, well. Right. Okay, so see her afterwards about the May Fair, which is in May, presumably. Claire, do come up.
Can't let you down, Dion, and not have notices.
No.
Three short notices. The first, I can see some amazing bunny ears here. I wish we all had bunny ears as well to celebrate the new life of Easter. If you would like to continue in a journey of faith, of discovering what it is to be Easter people, and you would like to just be on a mailing list that you get one email a week, which just tells you what service is the next day and any other notices that are going on in the church, just maybe speak to me afterwards and I can make sure you get that. Secondly, to say that next Sunday is all-age worship, so there are included within the service are activities for children and young people and us of all ages, where we don't mention our number anymore. Do we, Rita? She's not hearing me at the moment. Then I'm going to unroll the scroll. And these are available at the back. These are just a list of all the dates from now until the end of the year for the Taste of Teze services. So on the second Sunday in the evening from 5 o'clock, there is free soup and bread here, homemade soup and bread here, followed by a 45-minute reflective service that people are generally finding helpful in the craziness of this world to keep focused on God and what God is doing in our lives and the lives of our community. Thank you.
Any other notices, Sandy? Yeah, just about to do it. Yeah. Reverend Amanda sends her love. She's really sorry that she couldn't be here. She loves you all dearly, and particularly on this day, she's missing you all, so she sends her love. Amanda sends her love, Rita. Can I just say, if you're watching online live or at some later time, welcome to our Easter service. I should have said that at the beginning. You're most part of our family as well. So sorry it's late and at the end of the service, but we acknowledge your presence. So happy Easter to you. On the 21st of August, not August. 21st of April is our APCM. It'll be immediately after our morning worship. If you would like to stand as church warden, or if you'd like to stand on our PCC, nominations are open. Can you fill out a form at the back? You'll need a proposer and a seconder. All right. We need a new treasurer. We need at least one church warden. And a lot of our PCC members were co-opted because of the parish profile. So 21st of April, not August, for that. Now, I think the neighbours have been asleep for long enough, so I challenge you to sing this song as loudly as you can, and let's wake up our neighbours, shall we? Our final hymn is number 672, Thine Be the Glory.
Thine be the glory.
God, who through the resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ has given us the victory, give you joy and peace in your faith. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you and remain with you always. Amen.
Go in the peace of Christ. Alleluia, alleluia.
Thanks be to God.
Alleluia, alleluia.